弁当
みたいな。ああ、ありますあります。
カフェラテ。
じゃなくて。
もうまだ誰もやってこないから。
でも確かに1回目、多分初めて行った時にやらかして怒られて
ポイントカードですね。恐れ入ります。こちら下5点以上。東京キルイッツでこちら510円でございます。ありがとうございます。510円ちょうどお預かりいたします。お店でもレシートとご一緒にお持ちくださいませ。
ありがとうございます。
頑張れ俺。人生はレモルマン。
simulate the operation, and often when we're uncertain based on the imaging whether this operation is feasible, we have to explore the child and the operation to determine feasibility. So we open up the child, we have a look, and if the anatomy is suitable, we then go ahead with taking the donor kidney out, which could be mum or dad, usually at Guy's Hospital, and then the kidney is then brought over to Great Ormond Street or to a children's hospital. That's quite a stressful situation for the transplant. You've got two of your loved ones on the operating table at the same time, and you're not quite sure if it's going to be there. So I want to work out ways in which we could possibly de-risk that whole process. So, Stuart, I went to a lecture on 3D printing by my colleague Bert, the Department of Physics, and he was talking about 3D printing for hearts and other areas, and I asked him, do you think we could 3D print a human kidney and a baby's abdomen? So we put it to the test. So this is the machine that we use. It's housed in the Department of Medical Physics St. Thomas's Bodyguard Charity. It's a really incredible piece of kit. Now this is the process for the cell to create a 3D model. So this is for a heart. So we extract relevant anatomical data from CT scans and MR scans. We create this computer-aided design, and then we place that design essentially through the 3D printer using this software. And I've got a video of that here. So this is one. This is a heart that they did. So again, you draw around the various anatomical structures that you're interested in. By the way, this is fast forwarded. This takes about 40 hours. But it's quite remarkable. So we eventually developed the different layers of the heart, and you can see it's really quite beautiful, isn't it? So that heart then, that design, that computer-aided design, is then processed through the printer. And the printer lays down liquid plastic resin, which is modeled under UV light, to form a morphological structure. And that process takes about 12 hours or so. So we put it to the test for pediatric kidney transplantation. So you saw the scan here of the child who had the plastic graft. Now this child actually had a conventional operation. We explored the child on the operating table, and it was done by Professor Mamode, and we found an area of the aorta just there, a native bit of aorta which we put the kidney onto. And so what we did, this was a retrospective case, we decided to 3D print the vessels, 3D print the kidney, and we had two specific aims. One was to confirm whether there was geometrical correlation between the extracted anatomical data, the file, and the model, and there was. And the second thing is it actually useful? So we showed it to five independent surgeons, completely blind of the case, and they all agreed that this was a very useful model, and they identified where quite clearly they could do the anastomosis, which is joining up of the kidney's blood vessels onto the native piece of aorta. So that was encouraging. We then translated this into our very first case, prospectively. So this is the case of Lucy Boucher. She is a 10-kilogram child that was referred to us from Belfast. Now, she was born with kidney failure. She also had quite extensive surgery at the time because of blood supply to her gut. So we worried about scarring, and she was quite a small baby, as you can see. And her dad was the donor, so we took dad's right kidney just here. And this is her abdomen that we printed, and you can see the size discrepancy, can't you? It's quite evident on that photo there. Now, the printer has the amazing ability to print in different properties. So the pelvis was printed in a hard material, and the liver and the other soft tissues were printed in a softer material. Now, it doesn't exactly replicate human and tissue elasticity, but something that we could perhaps work on a bit later. But the anatomical geometry from the scans matched up to the model, and then we worked out possibly where we could put the kidney onto in terms of space. Now, I've got a video here of Professor Mamode manipulating the kidney onto the model. So he's actually interacting with the models now before the operation. A few days before, not on the day, but just to let you know. Okay, so you can see it's assessing here the best approach of the blood vessels here, the kidney, to the baby's blood vessels just here. Assessing the best lie of the kidney within the abdomen. whether we might need to mobilise the liver, possibly to create space. And importantly, the model told us whether we needed to possibly think about taking the native kidney out of the baby, because you see that's the front of a walnut, in order to create space. And because the model gives us an idea of depth perception, as it were. And we thought perhaps looking at the model we didn't have to do that, but of course that's a decision we take at the time of theatre as well. And it also gives us an indication, first incision, you can just see that there. And again, we showed it to 5 independent surgeons who felt, again, it was a very useful tool for surgical planning. And that operation went successfully, and she's doing very well. So this is just another example of another case, 14-kilogram child. So this is a child whose aorta splits very high. It's meant to split at the same level as the vena cava. So here's the vena cava, that's the level, the normal anatomy there. But this splits very high. And actually, you can see it's crossing over on itself, almost like a trouser leg, right? It's just crossing over. So we presented these images to our multidisciplinary team, and there was divided opinion as to the best place where we can put the kidney onto. In fact, some surgeons said that it's not feasible, some of them said it was. So we printed the model, we took it back to the multidisciplinary team, and 100% of them agreed that the operation is feasible. And we agreed to perhaps put it onto there for the artery and then on the vein. And that's what happened in the operating theatre. So where we planned to join the kidney onto, that's exactly what we found in surgery. And we actually had the model in theatre with us, and we referred to it 3 or 4 times as well, which was again very encouraging. Now, we've only done a few cases, we need to do more to evaluate it. And we are getting referrals now from Hong Kong and from Europe for this technology, for the use of this technology, so that's really encouraging. What else are we doing with 3D printing? Well, this is Professor Dasgupta, Professor of Robotics at GIES. We're now starting to study looking at the usefulness of printing 3D prostates with cancer in, to help plan difficult robotic prostatectomies. But we've also got one last very unique look, application of 3D printing, and this is hot off the press. This is actually using 3D printing to train in robotic transplantation. So what we do here, we create a 3D model of a pelvis of a recipient, a 3D model of a kidney, and on the actual pelvis, we create gaps in the blood vessels deliberately, and in those gaps we put real blood vessels from stored blood vessels that we've got from NHS. You see, this is a bank of stored vessels, blood vessels that we normally use, and then you put that under the robotic arms, and then you can practice your stitching. So here's a video just to show you that. So there's a 3D printed kidney. And that's the actual pelvis that's 3D printed. You can see the gaps we've created deliberately in that model. And what we do now is we get these stored vessels that we've got from NHSPD. We've got this design here that we introduced the vessel. And you can see here, this is actually a real blood vessel from a deceased donor that we're attaching onto those gaps. So there we go, that's in place now. So we take that into place, and then you place the whole stack under the robotic arms, and then you attach some blood vessels to the kidney, and then you're away, you're practicing. Can you see? So that's a hybrid model, using real tissue with 3D printing. So this is Mr. Luca Poulos, who's leading this project with us, trying to actually do that mastectomy. And that's what it really looks like. Obviously, you've got blood there, which you don't have in the model. But so the idea of this is to try and do that joining up as quickly and efficiently as possible, because you've got about 30 minutes to do that. Because don't forget, the kidney is not having any blood going in. It's not in ice either, so it's in sort of a strange position, really. So the idea is that you've got to try and do that within about half an hour. And the more you practice with a system like this, the better you're going to get. And we're just starting a validation study on that now. So what have we learned so far from 3D models? Well, they provide appreciation of anatomy, they're easy to understand and translate clinically, they allow surgery to be simulated, but importantly, they allow also for an informed consent process. So I can take these models and show them to a family and they immediately relate to them because they're morphologically specific to them. So I say, this is your kid, so it helps in terms of explaining the operation, explaining the risks of the operation, in addition to the diagrams and other information that we give. And that's one of the greatest value actually of the models. The second thing is you can actually build up an archive of these models that you can then train the future generation of surgeons with all the various bits of anatomy. And I've got some models here actually. So here's the actual one I was going to show you. So this is the model with the twisted aorta, and that's the size of the kidney. See? And we put it onto there. So you can have a look at these a bit later. Okay. This was the first time really this has been done in the UK and probably in the world. And there's Lucy now. And that's the time of the operation, and there she is now, 18 months on, handing her model over to the Science Museum, and that's her new life thinks here today, and we thank her for that. So those models are going to be on permanent exhibition from 2019 in the Science Museum. So I just want to end that really with some quotes from Lister and Faraday, which I think really underpin the fabric of my entire talk. So Lister said that there is only one rule, put yourself in the patient's place. And I think that's a very powerful aphorism for any doctor, really. And here are some of the patients that we've treated. Here are the donors, the fathers giving kidneys to their children. And this particular photograph is quite special because Professor Modi transplanted these three children in 24 hours. This child got a liver transplant, this child got a kidney transplant, and this child also got a kidney transplant. And all the three organs came from a single pediatric child, or a pediatric dad. So one child saved three children there. So I think all these photographs really give a very powerful meaning to what Joseph Lister said. And of course I must end with my hero Michael Faraday. It's a very rare photograph here of Michael Faraday at work. But still try, for who knows what is possible. And I hope that in the last hour or so I've managed to convey to you the excitement really of working at that interface between science and medicine to create some of those possibilities for our patients. So thank you very much.
Thank you. なかなかさ、でもハワイ行ってもさ、ね、
寝れながらも楽しむみたいな。
らしい。
時間もないわ、なんか。
一生懸命相手の方が考え
てる。そうだね、本当にそう思う。こんなさ、一人に対して気に注意しないでさ。でも彼と一緒に行くみたいな感じなんですか。
ね、
いるもんね。
自分ってでもなんかあるのかな、
あるんですか、
お母さんとして
はお母さんとも一緒だから、
お母さんとも一緒だから、お母さんとも
一緒だから、
お母さんとも一緒だから
、お母さんとも一緒だから、丸々座ってるか分かんないから、
自分の家賃
もいいし、
家賃もいいし、
家賃もいいし、家賃もいいし、家賃もいいし、